I was really glad to hear, read her friend and was able to get her to come today, so. Before we get started, one note on your papers, your biography papers. I just got them back this morning. I'm going to keep them over the weekend because I want to take a look at them myself. You all did pretty well, okay? And I, yeah, they're mainly A's and B's, so don't worry about it. It's 20% of your grade. I do have your grades. If after class you want to come and see me, I can tell you your percentage, okay? Otherwise, I'm going to keep them till Tuesday. All righty?
Are you talking about with the new paper in with our grade? With the biography in the grade? Is that what you're saying? The grade with the biography included? Does that make sense? The overall grade is including the biography?
I'm telling you about your biography paper.
And you said if you want us to, if we can come up at the end of class to see your overall grade or the grade?
No. Did I say overall? I just mean your paper grade.
Okay.
I don't have it overall. Okay. You can add up what you got. You know, you can do your percentages, right?
I was so confused far. About how you said it. I'm sorry. That's why I
okay. clarified. No, it's just your grade for this paper.
Okay.
All right. Any other questions? So come on up, Teresa. You want me to show the... Come on up and introduce yourself. Let me know when you want me to start right. the video, okay?
Okay.
Do you want a chair over here? Or you want
no,
to stop?
I'm good.
Okay.
So I wanted to start off my talk with a video, and it's called State of Oregon. And not only because I'm a native Oregonian, but because recently I found out that I'm a protester, an activist, an advocate, and all of these things that are part of the response that I had to direct violence that happened to my family. My nephew was killed in September of 2010, right down the street in Old Town, when he went to see a concert. He asked his dad if he could go to the show. And he was like, no, you can't go to the show, you know. Then he asked his mom, can I go to the show? And, you know, if the parents aren't in the same family, sometimes the child can, you know, kind of manipulate that relationship and get what they need out of it. And so he wanted to really go and see this show. And he's really, you know, like was into art and rap and hip hop and everything else community. But he really wanted to go see the show. So he was, you know, he was allowed to go downtown to the Barracuda nightclub to see an 18 and over hip hop show. And about 3 minutes after he got downtown, he called his mom to say, you know, I made it down here, I'm here. And within the next 6 minutes, he was on the ground with bullets in his body, and he was killed. Like, he died the next morning. Before Sunday morning, he was dead. And I got up to OHSU because I had come home to visit. My nephew had, my uncle had just did like 27 years in jail. And so I was coming home to visit because in my family, because of all this, I call it segregation, people call it gentrification, whatever. But when I came home and I saw that our community wasn't together, people kept saying, you know, when your uncle get out, you know you gotta be out here, because first of all, it's illegal for him to be at certain people's houses. It's illegal for him to be around children. It's illegal for him to go in the community. And everybody that was here when he went in is like either dead or they got children. And so we don't have a big homecoming for him, and you need to come here and be home for him. So I came home from Texas, where I had lived for 15 years, took myself out of Portland for a while. But I came home to visit because of that reason. And during the time that I was visiting for that reason, I started getting engaged in things that were happening in my community. Now, mind you, I was only supposed to be here for a couple of weeks, but I hadn't been home for 11 years. So the things that I noticed in our community had me kind of on edge, because I kept noticing, like, when I would go places in the neighborhood, people would look at me like as if they were waiting for me to leave, like coffee shops with my laptop up and my to-go cup that I didn't ask for. They'd be looking at me like, oh, she's still here, you know. And I thought that was amazing, because I'm like, I grew up on this block, but it's weird that people are in here like really feeling like, making me feel like I shouldn't be here. And then last Thursday came around, and some of my friends, I was like, oh, they got this thing that's going on, let's go over there. Oh, that's not for us. And I was like, what do you mean things are not for us? And I'm just kind of, you know, tripping off of how much the community changed and how much work we as a family had to do in order to deal with my uncle coming home to this. Not only did I not recognize what was going on, I didn't know any of my friends. I didn't know where everybody was, so I knew that his issues were going to be compounded coming home. But what I didn't know was that the same day that he was going to be released, we were going to be having my nephew's funeral, who was 19 years old, the same age as my uncle was when he went to jail. And you see, I keep accidentally saying nephew, uncle, because it's just really crazy when in your family, people have a life expectancy, if they're men, to 19. whether they're 19 and they die, or they're 19 and they go to jail, or they're 19 and they commit suicide like my godson did a couple years ago, or something detrimental. So my response to all of that was to like learn more, audit, ask questions, demand answers, demand changes. I didn't even know what kind of changes could be demanded, but I knew that if people didn't just assume that opportunities were not for them, but that they assumed that those opportunities were being brought there because of their issues or their involvement or their society, and that all they had to do was have access to those opportunities so that they could build and bridge some of the motivations that they need to make it better for us. That's what I needed to happen, but I came against like big barriers. You hear Donald Trump talking about building walls. In Portland, we have barriers, we have gates, we have gatekeepers, and the keepers of the provisions for people that are marginalized, right? The keepers of the provisions, the keepers of our intellect, the keepers of our resources, whatever we're supposed to need, there are people that keep our voices, and they speak for us, they do things supposedly for us, their motivation, their political agendas, what I call criminal negligence, because it's to the detriment of our community safety, but their opportunities matter more than our lives. And so when I saw that the issue with having access in my community and the issue with people getting past the age of 19, 21, or even having the American dream, whatever we thought that was this gatekeeper existence of qualified, wherever the people, patriarchy, I guess I'm learning, the patriarchs, when I realized that all I wanted to do was smash it. I didn't know that made me an activist. I didn't know it made me an advocate. I didn't know it made me revolutionary. All I knew was that that was the only thing that could help me sustain myself in the grief that I'm dealing with in regards to what's happening in my world. And my world includes your world, because when I grew up in our community, it wasn't segregated. It wasn't as dysfunctional as it is now. My friends didn't have to wear tags and titles to identify who they were. And just knowing the people in your community, you already had a safe place, because those is your neighbors, really? So you're safe because you grow up with them, your parents work with them, you guys pay taxes, you live in the same neighborhoods, you go to the same parks, library, school. So the outcome that you want in your world is a sustainable effort in doing that, just taking care of each other, building. But it's like it's not appropriate to want that unless you have a gatekeeper that says that it's okay to assign that task to you for that. So I'm fighting that system. I don't give a fuck about it. I want it to break. I don't want to see that at the table. I want to break the table and build a new table. And so I'm going to show you this video that my friend Adele, who's also like me-minded and from Portland, she made a video about some of the circumstances that I'm talking about, and then I'm going to talk to you guys about how you feel about this. And I don't know how that works, but thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Sounds good.
I want to get to as many calls as possible tonight, and I'm hoping that we'll hear from people across the country. And we heard from Kelly in Portland, Oregon. Hi, Kelly. What do you want other Americans to understand that it feels right now that they just don't?
Well, we've been talking here about how we're in a blue bubble. You know that liberal smugness? I like
they're not. They're smug and not self-aware about it, is what you're saying.
Exactly, yeah. Sometimes I say Portland's a liberal town that hasn't really been tested. There's just not that much diversity here.
New tonight, a grieving mother searching for answers after a brutal attack on her son.
On August 10, 2016, just before midnight, Larnell Bruce Jr. was murdered in Gresham, Oregon, a low-income suburb of the next highway exit east of Portland. His killer, Russell Courtier, a known member of a white supremacist gang, and his girlfriend, Colleen Hunt, pulled up to the 7-Eleven on 188th and Burnside, where Larnell was charging his phone outside. A fight immediately erupted as the men crossed paths, and Courtier threw Bruce against the store window, shattering the pane. But witnesses say the 6'2", 19-year-old was winning the fight.
Then the white guy was about to pick up one of those tire irons.
And Larnell pulled out a large knife. The clerk yelled the police were on their way, and Courtier got back into the Jeep with Colleen. Larnell is seen on camera walking away, but the couple pursued him.
Portier's girlfriend admitted to police. She yelled, "Get him, baby! Get him, baby!"
Witnesses on the scene shouted, "Run, they're trying to kill you." The teen sprinted in the direction of his mother's apartment.
My son was murdered. He was murdered by a racist. I feel like a part of my heart is just ripped. It's so horrible. It's horrendous.
New for 19, disturbing new court documents, a history of violence, and possible connections to a racist prison gang. Tonight, new questions about the man accused of intentionally running over a teenager in Gresham.
Larnell Bruce Jr., do you know who he
is? I don't know him, sorry.
Oh, he was run over by a white supremacist on
High Street. I do remember. I'm sorry, yes, I do remember that situation. Yeah.
Right. So,
who could possibly, horrible, I mean.
If Portland don't care about it, then the rest of the world don't see Portland caring about it, then they don't care. BET put it out there, Huffington Post, Metro, Daily Mail, Sean King put it out there, everybody put it out there, and it still didn't take off because it was a black kid in Portland.
When I first heard that he was run over, I first thought about a young man by the last name of Devin. 1970, right over here on Russell Street and Union Avenue, now MLK. And some white racists came by, stopped at the corner. He was on the telephone, and they put a shotgun to the phone box, and they murdered him right there. That's what I thought about. Nobody ever talks about that. Nobody ever tells that story. But I know how it affected us. It made us realize once again that just like when we were little kids, we had to have that power of observation that our parents taught us. That you always have to be looking around.
Despite Oregon's reputation as a liberal white bastion, the murder of Larnell Bruce Jr. is a window into a lesser known history.
A lot of people wonder why Oregon is so white, or they don't wonder about it and should. And you know, Oregon was founded as the white only state. I mean, the Oregon Land Donation Act that gave land to settlers for the Oregon Trail was for white people only.
When Oregon entered the Union as a free state in 1850, 2 years before the Civil War, blacks and Native Americans were explicitly denied citizenship in its constitution, which was not amended until 1926. All over the state, artificial sundown laws determined where people of color could be shot if caught after dark. Gresham is rumored to be a former sundown town. CCTV records Russ narrowly missing Larnell, who pivots 180 degrees and runs for his life. Enraged, Russ sped against oncoming traffic to mow the teen down, dragging Larnell's body under the wheels of the Jeep before speeding off. Police arrived and found Larnell motionless in the street, blood gushing from his head and ears. He never spoke another word and languished a few more days in the hospital before he died, days shy of his 20th birthday. Russell Portier and Colleen Hunt were arrested and charged with murder on August 18, 2016. But Portier's prison records, published by the Portland Mercury, revealed Russ's association with white supremacist prison gang European Kindred. In total, Portier has 7 felony and 4 misdemeanor convictions and a lengthy juvenile record. Russ was on parole the night he killed Larnell for stabbing a woman. A year earlier, he bashed a man unconscious with a pool ball drunk at a bar. Portier spent 12 days in jail, and the charges were dropped. A month after the murder charges were filed, a Multnomah County grand jury reindicted Russ and Colleen with a hate crime enhancement. European Kindred members showered Portier with support on Facebook. "Love you, Russ. Keep your head up." Another wrote, "They tested Kindred, and homeboy did not hesitate."
Do you think Russell Portier and Colleen will be found guilty of murder?
Klux Klan was and is a terrorist organization. Violent Nazi skinheads are terrorist organizations. When you take 9/11 out of the picture, it's almost all white right-wing extremists. So there's a concern that those guys have a green light and that they're not going to be watched.
Hail Trump! Hail our people! Hail victory!
And that they're on board with this larger analysis of the world as a racial battle zone.
On May 26, 2017, Jeremy Christian, a lifelong felon and professed white supremacist, stabbed three men on a Portland MAX train, killing two. When they disrupted his attack on two teenage girls, one wearing hijab, the other African American. Since August 2016, both Russell Courtier and Colleen Hunt remain incarcerated at Multnomah County Inverness Jail, awaiting trial for the murder of Larnell Bruce Jr., which has been postponed until February 20th, 2018.
So, yeah, my friend Adele Free Fam, that movie played at the New York Met last summer in August. And when we talk about not speaking truth to power or bringing up things that embarrass us, the fact that it was playing in New York City at this big, giant, you know, festival for 100 films, and the fact that we also had it playing in a screening in the Pearl District along with an exhibition that we call Stolen Angels that included all of these children from Portland that have been murdered in either community violence, police brutality, suicide, all these different ways that our children have been taken from us due to their marginalization or the depression or the society's normalization around the violence that is happening to them. No one knew about that movie. And I wonder how many people in here even know the name Larnell Bruce by a show of hands before you saw this movie.
Wow.
And he was murdered here in Portland by a white supremacist. How many people know about all of the activists' protests against white supremacy in Portland? And yet we've never heard the name Larnell Bruce. One of the things that I realized before Donald Trump had even been elected as president was that in our community for years, for decades, if you listen to what the Willamette Weekly put out or the Mercury put out about Russell Courtier, over 40 instances of violent criminal activity, including stabbing and shooting and robbing people. He was a paid informant also. But what you have to understand is that children like Quantas Hayes, when we talk about what are you doing for black lives, what are you doing about black on black crime, children, 17-year-olds like Quantas Hayes, how many of you know his name? He was a 17-year-old child that was murdered by the police last year in February as he was told to crawl and put his hands up by two different officers, and they murdered him. They shot him three times, once in his head, once in his chest, and once in his abdomen. 17 years old, about 120 pounds, crawling, being told to crawl, officers with AK-47s on him, a whole SWAT team, saying, crawl, put your hands up. They know that he's a kid. They found him a couple of years before. They knew him from the Boys and Girls Club. They knew him from the Portland Police Activities League. They knew this kid. They had found the kid before with like a plastic toy gun. And so they had told him as a child with a plastic toy gun that is sold at stores that you could lose your life. I could shoot you in your head if I see you outside with that gun. What grown-up says that to a child? But it's okay for a grown-up, for an officer, to say that to a black child. And what the point is that I'm trying to make is that when we watch this movie and we think about white supremacy and we think about the lives of the children in our community, the most marginalized people in our community, not meaning a lot to this city. The fact that nobody in here knew Larnell Bruce's name kind of adds value to that statement. The fact that we know that white supremacy has risen over, we have 18 known hate groups in the city of Portland right now in Multnomah County. And we don't know any of the names of people that have been killed by white supremacists here in Multnomah County. The fact that our district attorney, knowing that nobody knows about it, didn't even want to force a hate crime on this issue. And that February date of his trial, that's been pushed over to September, and they're saying that it might take place in March of 19. That means he doesn't matter. And the fact that the city is talking about sanctuary for all of our immigrant communities and all of our communities that have been marginalized, and we don't even know that people are being murdered in our community because of who they are and what they look like by white supremacists that have been re-released into the community from the jails where they have been indoctrinated and where their cells are growing from 11 in 2016 to 2018, where they're building a movement and we don't even consider them gangs. So what happens in America and the reason that we have to advocate, activate, be humiliated in saying Black Lives Matter or Our Lives Matter or Don't Discriminate Against My Gender and all those different things that we have to say right now in America, that we have to say, that we're being forced to say, is because fear is a factor. Ignorance is a factor. Shame is a factor. When you shame a community because of their situation and their proximity to poverty, to the point where they don't speak out and they don't sit at the table and they don't legislate and they don't engage and they don't promote civic engagement and they don't ask for the things that they need to build a viable community. When you shame them for being poor, when you shame them for being women, when you shame them for being black, when you shame them for being disabled, of course you're not gonna hear them speaking out. And if at any point that they start to speak out, what that suggests is that it's time for us to support them. Because if it had to take something catastrophic to get that person, that very marginalized person that America still does not see as an equal person in America, like they're still a second-class citizen, if they are prompted to move and to make a voice louder than where they're already at, our job in this country as neighbors is to elevate that voice and to build on that message. Because we should all feel safe. What's wrong with us when that's not part of our indoctrination and we still clout that we are the land of the free, home to brave, and that liberty matters here? Ignorance. Ignorance has been used as a weapon against us in this fight. The fact that people in our community don't know their own history and that in these institutions you know more about my history and my culture and art and language and everything about us than I do. And the fact that when we come against academia, or policymakers, or anybody with power and authority, the fact that we are ignorant people without knowledge, without the opportunity to appropriate access to knowledge, without the opportunity to buy in to class, we're further humiliated when we're speaking at the table that we're supposed to be at, not on. It's your job as individuals in this class getting this information to build a system that includes us. Not because you want to be the guardian or the savior or the warrior, because you want to design something different. You want to have something different. You want to have access to something different in the future. We don't have it now. We don't even have the intention right now. We don't care enough about people to hear them. And so when we use their ignorance against them and we deny them access because they can't articulate things, we have to look at the ignorance it takes to not help someone. How afraid are you? How ashamed are you that you would not reach your hand out to provide an olive branch to someone screaming for their life? Literally begging for their lives in America. Fear is another factor that has held us back. Fear. the constituted fear, the propagated fear that I'm dangerous, that I'm strong, that I got this superpower, that I've mastered hate and violence, that the point of me showing up is a violent spectacle, that the point of me crying out or speaking out is something that I should be ashamed of, that people that humiliate me should be awarded for, accredited for humiliating people that are screaming and begging for their lives. Educated people should understand better than us that don't have that education. I don't know what Marxism is, Leninism. I got the list of books that y'all reading about revolution. I ain't never read none of them. I'm going out to McLaren tomorrow with Angela Davis, Dr. Angela Davis, to meet with kids that I've been working with that are institutionalized, that ain't never getting out. They're going to the Department of Corrections. We're giving them books. What do you think our expectation is of those children? That they gotta use what they get, that information, be less ignorant, build, research, develop, program, share, be accepted, be included, have access to academia, so that you can use that access to change the world? What part of that ask is a problem? What part of that ask is violence? That's what I'm still trying to understand. What part of that ask makes people feel like my life don't matter and what I'm saying is something that's putting them down? When someone is screaming out for help, they're not putting anyone down. They're not lacking consideration for anyone's response. They need all of it. People do need to be validated. All of us do. We do need to be heard. All of us do. We do need to be helped. All of us do. We do need to be inspired. We need to be encouraged. We need to be loved. We need to be understood. We need to be guided. We still need to be educated. We need you to get this degree. We need you to go out into the world, and we need to do whatever you can to make a change. That's my demand. I'm in here protesting today. Thank you.
Sons who I brought here when they were 4 and 7 or something like that, 6 and 9 or something like that. But I'm glad, well, one of them came back and is going to school here. But I'm kind of glad, my son that graduated from Grant in 2006, mm-hmm. When he comes back, he don't go out because it is unsafe. And my other son, who's back going to college, when he came back, he was away at college, and he came back. And he was pulled over by the gang task force, broken tail light,
Yeah.
And they looked him up. They detained him as a passenger to look him up to see was he in the gang task force, simply because he's black. What about, there was a kid I remember who was pulled over by the police, and they told him his car was too nice. So I fear for my son.
Yeah.
We fear for our children, and I'm glad that my other son, he's the darker one, that he's not here. The other one's lighter, maybe that makes it easier, but it makes a difference.
Yeah.
It makes a difference. So thank you so much for sharing. You are an inspiration. I forget, I was thinking of one of those chapters in one of our books that we're reading. It talks about the evangelist. You're the evangelist. Producing emotion. And it's inspiring with spirit. Sharing your pain. I appreciate it. But it is. I remember that Larnell Bruce incident. But the fact that it's not being protested. I mean, we are living in scary times, and this place is the epitome. The Northwest is the place for white supremacy, right?
And not just the fact that we're not protesting, but the fact that we're not organizing around being safe and making sure that our neighbors are safe and making sure that we're aware that these cells are growing in our community. For years, we've said, like, there's over 200 unsolved homicides in the Black community, and they've attributed them to gang violence, which they're not being investigated, just like my nephew's death. And what we're learning recently is that a lot of people are not being arrested, and they're white people that are killing Black people. We had a 17-year-old white kid that killed a Black kid in January on the 23rd over a suspected weed deal. He thought he was gonna be getting robbed, and even though he had a shotgun in his trunk, and he also killed the kid with a .357, the kid that he killed didn't have a weapon on him. And everybody was like, he just came outside to smoke the weed. But in his mind, that's what the police are saying, why they didn't arrest the other kid, the white kid that killed the Black kid, because in his mind, he felt like someone was going to rob him. Now, the kid that he thought was gonna rob him was sitting in front of him in the car, and he shot him from the back, and the kid jumped out of the car and ran and then collapsed. They went and stole the kid's phone. Nobody saw any toy gun, real gun, or anything on him. They rolled off, they didn't report anything. It came back later, and they still, there's no charges. There's no arrest. But in my community, that child would have probably been a murderer while the arrest was happening, for probably running, or if they would have gotten arrested, because we would have found out that they killed a white kid or they killed a Black kid and they would have got arrested, we would have known their names. I'm working with parents right now who can't even get the names of their children who are killing their children, because the children that killed them are white kids. And I'm saying children for 19-year-olds and 20-year-olds and 17-year-olds, because these are people's children and they've been motivated to hurt each other. They've been motivated to hurt each other, murder each other. And as a community, we've been motivated to not make that our problem and to not care enough to, even the news doesn't want those type of ratings because they're not reporting it. And when they do report it, it's very quick and it's over. Just like Larnell, you had international press around that child that got murdered out here in a place where it's just been recently gentrified, and there's a lot of marginalized community members out there, and a lot of those people, including the white allies, have said, I've been getting literature from the Ku Klux Klan for months. I call the police because I'm tired of the stuff coming to my house, and they're telling me, ignore it. It's no problem. Eat the candy. There should be an investigation when a known terrorist hate group is suggesting that people join them to promote and propagate hate in a community where the neighbors, like, their kids go to school together. They live in the same freaking neighborhoods. Those children don't know the hate that's in their parents' hearts yet. But as a society, we're telling them why they should understand that. But as a society, we're not telling them why they should not, or what they should do about it, or even that it exists. So it's easy to indoctrinate it. When we don't speak about it, it's very easy to indoctrinate them, because all they have to do is have a bad day, have somebody suggest that they don't matter that day, and have no one to go to help them understand what that means, how to digest that, what to do with it, where they can be. We're getting what we want out of society because we're getting what we put into it. If we're doing nothing, if we're saying nothing, if we're acquiescent, if we're complicit, then that's what we're gonna get. We can't see our way around that. You're not gonna see anything change unless you're a part of that. Like, you actually have to be the action. When we talk about action plan, you actually have to insert yourself in these spaces to be utilized. Whatever you're going to school for, whatever your major is, whatever your focus for the future is, you have to put a social justice lens of inclusion and equality, not equity. Equity is a return on investment. You might just start counting data. And then that's a hustle. You have to look at building equality. Dismantle the patriarchy. Any more questions? I don't know if anybody gave one, but I know Carolyn's speaking. Yes, sir.
Can you talk more about Trump shooting?
Yes. So my nephew was murdered September 26th of 2010. And at the time, I was registered as a Black woman of peace with Multnomah County under District 2 Barbara Wheeler, who was the commissioner at the time, Northeast Portland. And this was a group of 40 women of color that were basically getting together to kind of build like ideas around the community violence, around gang violence. And I had been in Texas for about 15 years, so I just happened to be at this table while I'm waiting for my uncle to be released from jail. The weeks that I'm home, I'm at the Multnomah County Commissioner's office sitting in a room with women that I've seen my whole life as a child that were in this room. And I'm thinking while I'm in the space, like, wow, what am I doing here? They're gonna find out I don't live here and they're gonna put me out. Let me just sit back and check it out. I'll report back to my grandpa in the community that he asked me to represent. And I'll, you know, just keep my quietness so they don't realize that I'm in the room, because I'm very intimidated by all of these women, because again, I grew up in Portland. So I saw them when I was going to King's School. I saw them when I was going to Harriet Tubman. I saw them when I was at Jeff. I saw them the whole time I was growing up in every system I was in, foster care, you know, aftercare institutions, everywhere. They were always in the institutional partnerships with everything that was around my life. So I'm in there with them and they're talking about how they're gonna help people like me. And I'm listening to them and they're talking about, we're gonna buy the gang members some diapers and we're gonna do a talent show and let the kids come out and do this and that and give out prizes and do here and all this. And I'm thinking to myself, like, wow, that's really crazy that you guys are sitting here in Multnomah County where there's like hundreds of billions of dollars in the budget. All these very seriously strong political partnerships throughout the state. All these departments that are focused on community and social outreach and programming, and your answer to community violence and gang enforcement or interaction or whatever you want to call it is to buy diapers for gang members and to have talent shows for the marginalized children. Now, I like entertainment, but my thought is that if you have that much privilege and that much access to very serious fundamental systems, that you should think bigger. That you should basically give yourself the opportunity to identify resources that can help build that community. The community don't need to be fed or put on a pedestal to entertain people. We can't keep hustling off of poverty, wearing the shirt that says, you know, this and that doesn't matter as much as giving somebody access to information that can educate them. And so I started using my mouth. I started, you know, instead of being quiet and listening to them, I was like, those aren't really innovative partnerships. I know you want to bring art to the kids and everything, but those aren't innovative partnerships. I'm looking in at your PowerPoint, and you have, like, the gang task force, and you have DHS, and you have the city of Portland, and you have the Oregon Youth Authority, and you have the juvenile justice system, you have the Department of Corrections as community partners to make our lives better. I said, that's where you stuck. That's not gonna make our lives better. Those systems are not for making lives better. Those are institutional systems that house people. So if you wanna make the lives better, what you gotta do is look at your other network of partners, community partners, you know, Willamette Industries, Tillamook, Nike, Bank of America, Wells Fargo, all these different corporate systems that are out here funneling themselves into all these programs. You need to look at them for answers. You need to utilize what they're giving you and the value of a logo on a flyer. And you need to take that and create an educational component. Let's say, for instance, instead of the kids getting free tennis shoes, you take them on a trip to Nike and introduce them to patenting and distribution and merchandising and the legal criteria that goes into building a shoe. Why don't we do that? And instead of let's bend down with Wells Fargo, why don't we teach economic empowerment to the community? Why don't we go ahead and take advantage of some of those child, you know, accounts that they have, those IDAs that they have, and let's partner with some of these other partners like Willamette Industries and Tillamook, and let's talk about the institution of those industries and how those industries and those engineering degrees, how they matter, and how your innovative mind and how you see art and how you can produce products, services, and fees, how that matters. And if we bridge those corporate relationships with those institutions that have access to those people that are living in poverty, then guess what? Boom! It's going to be a difference. There's going to be a reflection. This is going to multiply. It's going to make things better. But continuing to put the logos on the flyers to put them up there so they can sing and dance for you, that's really not going to help nobody. Guess what table I wasn't invited to no more. 24 hours after I made that presentation with a proposal attached to it, that's when my nephew died. I left that table at 12 o'clock that afternoon saying that the community needed access to education. The community needed real access to partnerships. The community really wanted to build, and they knew what they needed, and they didn't need somebody doing a survey or data collection to figure out what they wanted. They just needed access to those same resources, whether they're education tools or whatever they are. Just put them in there. Stop obligating people to be the gatekeepers of information
when the information should be in the hands of those that need to be informed. They're gonna do something with it, I promise you. That's what they're waiting for. They ain't just sitting back waiting for somebody to do something for them. They're trying to figure out how to get something done, how to get past the barriers, how to get somebody to respond to them in a way that's decent and doesn't subject them to feeling humiliated for asking a question. Any more questions? Y'all don't have to feel humiliated.
So I like your ideas about instead of shoes, like keep them about, you know, marketing and what, you know, legal aspects of making a shoe. I imagine that's kind of part of your like rebuilding the table.
That's a community action plan.
Yeah, what else would be some other examples of how you rebuild the table?
I mean, you basically have to restructure your community. If I had all the answers, I wouldn't be in Trump's seat because I can't afford it, but I'm just saying, we wouldn't be in this classroom right now. We wouldn't be talking about this subject matter. I don't think there's anyone in our generation that knows actually what we need, but I believe that community building is the start. I think that self-advocacy, that promoting community advocacy and dismantling and redistributing services that are going into communities, direct to community grassroots organizations, that's the biggest start for a foundation building. On Don't Shoot Portland, on all of our banners, it says a community action plan. I used to work for an accountant. I did business development. I think that everything that we need to do needs to be developed and organized and built as an operational tool for community engagement. I think we need to stop selling everything to each other, and we need to start building together so that we can have more value in the things that are happening. But we don't. We're too busy trying to figure out how to hustle. And that's the part that's broken, is that hustle. We've legislated ourselves into debt, but at the expense of human life. When my nephew died, one of the first things that I realized was how much money went into institutions and agencies and organizations that dealt with child's death, like gang violence. Like, everybody got paid. And I couldn't believe it because they were touting how many unsolved homicides they had, and they were still trying to figure out what to do with the kids. And I'm like, how do you get money when the kids that your directives are to promote safety to and to support and mentor and tutor and all that stuff, how do you get money for them when they keep dying? And when you ain't got no answers? And when your only job is to distribute victims' assistance money for the funeral? Like, how is that a plan? First thing I want to do is defund all their programs, every last one of them. I don't care. Like, y'all should not have anything to do with any child's life. Because if your thing is about collecting that information and talking about the problem that they got, and your job isn't doing something with your access to those children and the proximity to the problems that they're dealing with, your job ain't to solve those problems or build around what you know is already happening when you write the grant to say that you need the money for the and then you get it and then you want to research some more. If that's your only way of building community, that's the hustle. And that's what I've seen. I mean, even the, the Center for Public Integrity did an audit on the state of Oregon after I had done a couple of my audits. I got access to it in 2015-16. We got an F for accountability, ethics, oversight. Like, we hustle. Cronyism, nepotism, we do business with people that we know, even if they don't know how to do what is necessary when they get that money. And it's on the record. So I work with auditors.
What kind of support are you getting in that film? Mayor Wheeler looked pretty unconcerned about what was happening. What kind of, have you approached the city and going and trying to change these programs?
For years, when my nephew was murdered in 2010, I had a relationship with Mayor Adams at the time. I've actually been through three mayors, and none of them have decided to run a second term because in the 4 years that they have as mayor, and the fact that people are at the table making these concerns come to light and asking for accountability and instruction on what we can do as a community together, there's been a deflection. And again, when I first started this conversation, I talked about the barrier of gatekeepers, the intellectuals and the elites that they put in places where our voices should be. That's been my biggest issue with three different administrations. So working with the city as a victim survivor of violence and saying, being invited by one mayor, being introduced to the Multnomah County Health Department with that same mayor in mind, saying, hey, sit down with these people and You guys can start writing up programs. I started. The first program I wrote, they got $4.6 million from the CDC. They called it Striving to Reduce Youth Violence Everywhere. And then they used the money to research the youth violence everywhere in Multnomah County until they ran out of money. Elephant's Deli and all the different caterers that they had coming out and all the different trips that they took around the country and all the different data that they collected, they, with the CDC money, knowing already what the issues were, but they had to go out and share and collect data. It's a hustle. And so people like myself, these families that are out here that are saying, hey, help me, help me, help me. It's not that our taxpayers and the federal government ain't helping them. It's that the help that's coming to them is being derailed and deflected into pockets, priorities that have nothing to do with us. And we're discredited when we say something to them, because on the record, it looked like that's the leader. It looked like they're in a place and they're credentialed and, you know, respectable. And it looks like we're probably just being mean because we're not articulating to them what we really need. But the fact is they don't answer our calls. They don't sit at the table with us. They don't invite us to tables. They slam doors on us. They show up at the funerals with the cameras, and then they stage public relations afterwards. But when it comes to actually doing what needs to be done so that you can help the families that want to help themselves, they give us this every time. I got it on the record. I used to work for an auditor, so I've been keeping track of everything. I got over 3.5 million emails just from my nephew when he was murdered, because I wanted to track and document everything. And I didn't know how valuable that was, but 8 years later, when you're watching things dismantle and you're seeing the momentum from protest and activism coming together and people starting to communicate, and just the basic communication is getting people to do something different, well, that's change. And to be able to be respectful and to see that type of change, to be in the same world with it, that's why I come in and protest. I don't know how to just come in here and have a conversation with y'all. I gotta talk to you about what's happening so that you can use the power that you have to do something with it. Not to be subjected to knowing about it as if it's over there, but being subjected to understanding that it is a part of your life and our future together, period. Like, there's no way around having to be around people that you live with and share breath with. But we got patriarchy too.
So if we were to define a protest movement regarding this issue and advise a strategy plan to help,
mm-hmm.
What is the main issue? The fact that agencies that receive government funds are just spinning in circles,
yeah,
instead of actually doing something into the community that actually affects the lives of the children that are being...
They need to be called out. The voices that you hear saying, stop mass incarceration, stop the prison industrial complex, stop the nonprofit industrial complex, all of those things, they're all contributions to this problem that I'm speaking about. And so the more people that say, I reject that, just like right now with the gun debate and the children speaking out against the corporations that fund the legislation and the civic process and partnerships, it's making a difference because people are being forced to look at it and say, whoa, I didn't know that relationship existed that way. Oh God, now it kind of makes sense, because when we see information, we're able to disseminate it ourselves. Any community action plan, any nonviolent direct action, any protest, political campaign has to have the story of what's happening, but it also has to have what needs to be done, the call to action. And so when you brought that up, like, that's what I hate right there. When I'm talking about this system, I'm like, what a system would allow people to speak on behalf of voiceless community members when we have a constitution that says it's for the people, by the people, governed by the people, elected by the people, a democracy that allows us to position ourselves to believe that that's what we can get out of our elected leaders. But we don't have that. That's not available to everyone. And when we talk about white supremacy, it was set up that way. And we need to dismantle that, because that's not what this country was supposed to be built on. We know what it says on the written word, that yeah, that's what it is, but the lies, liberty, and justice for all, well, I want that to turn into reality. And I think that, you know, we can do that.
Do you, have you observed that certain institutions or groups of people seem to, like, be more ignorant to these issues of, like, our racist history and, like, the discriminatory police
of all these systems that have information, there's a reason behind that. We get to identify who's getting access to the information. And why would you want to identify who's getting access to information? Because you might want to discriminate against some people, right, at some point. And so if everybody has the same information and everyone's using that access to build their world, then how do we build our capitalist system that works? Like, we have a system that actually works the way that it was built. It's a standard. It doesn't work for us because we weren't the man that was described in that standard. But it works the way that it was set up. We can't allow that system to continue being a part of our indoctrination in this country. Not if we want to have the world that we believe is supposed to happen, that American dream. Like, it's not going to work with the standard that we live in right now. So. Any other questions?
What was the name of the center that did the audit?
The Center for Public Integrity. Yeah, their investigators were trying to contact me through my lawyer, too. I was excited about that. I was like, what? And I sent all my audits to the Department of Justice in Washington, but that was before this administration.
Okay, so our final project is to make a protest movement, to plan one. So if we all got together and planned a really good one and ran it through you, would you be interested in that?
Yeah. You ain't never had a protest, huh? Yeah, of course. And especially if it's something where we're elevating our relationships so that we're not. The problem with America is that we've defined, let's say, fellowship as assimilation, right? We've like, oh, if you don't listen and do and act and say what I say, then we can't be on the same page. We can. We're intrinsic people. We're supposed to have different ideas and different philosophies and different theories and thoughts and ideas and focuses and hobbies. And that's why we get to engage with each other, and that's why it's so stimulating to be able to have those engagements. Like, you get to talk to somebody that doesn't agree with everything you say. You know how much research happens after that? You can write it all down and then go home and spend hours learning about what your friend's thought process is. And they'll probably do the same, and that builds respect, even if you don't ever get to a point where you agree. But we don't have any of that right now. We have community members. I realized, like, when I first started protesting after the Ferguson uprisings, people had stopped speaking to their own family members. And I think stuff like that empowered the hate that we see in our communities right now, because when you're, like, let's say you're privileged and you're white and your family members don't listen to you because you know everything, you're hanging out with the black people and you're going to make them listen, you're going to make them listen, you're going to make them listen, if they don't listen, you're going to delete them. That's not helping nobody. You're still related to that person. That person is still related to other people in your family. The fact that you guys are no longer speaking over an issue regarding human rights means that both of y'all wrong. Because if you're not doing something to build that conversation in your family to define how y'all can get along, you can't go outside and say the world. You can't figure it out with your sister and your brother and your cousin and your grandma. And you're gonna go out there and try to regulate how we're all working together. And you're gonna try to ally with people that are marginalized, but you can't constructively have a conversation with your own family about what's happening, you're gonna get somebody hurt. You're gonna get somebody killed. When we talk about nonviolent direct action, when we talk about political campaigns that have protests connected to them, safety's the first thing that we're focused on. A lot of people have gotten mad at me because I refuse to protest with them. If you make me feel like you're gonna get me killed, I'm not gonna do it because I don't wanna be a martyr. I don't protest because I want somebody to see me and kill me or see me and care about me. I'm doing it because I'm trying to get the people that don't have a voice heard. I always throw the bullhorn to them because I know how to get my voice heard. I know how to octave and all that. But some people, I need to give them the bullhorn because whatever they told me, if somebody else hears it, we're gonna be able to get more done. But people don't want to hear each other. So make sure your messaging makes sense. When I went to organize with some kids at Oakley Green, they asked me, they said, well, why do you protest? And I said, because my nephew got murdered, and I want children like you guys to graduate from school without knowing any kids that got killed. I want by the time you graduate from high school that in the last 5 years from the time, and these are middle schoolers, so let's say in 4 years, you can look back 5 years and none of your friends died. That's why I'm protesting. I don't want you to know death like that. I want you to get old and bury your friends after you've been friends for years and got divorces and everything else.
like have a life, get some grandkids in your world, you know? Build something with your life. That's what we want. That's why we're protesting. And when you do your messaging, speak that life into it, because that's where the passion comes from. That's how you're able to influence other people. That's how you're able to encourage them. Because they know that their power is part of making that happen for you. You're not begging them, you demand it as humans. You said we share air. Help me breathe. Don't let me die. Protect my kids like you would protect yours. Let's be neighbors. That's all.
Yeah, you know, this is interesting because, you know, you're talking about safety, right? And so for me, from my point of view, part of what I was going to talk about, what I wanted to tell the class is how I'm disillusioned. I've been teaching community development for 20 years here, okay? But with the way things have turned in the last 5 years, just with the financial crisis, you know, the goal was always, you know, black home ownership will be the solution to, you know, economic uplift. Well, it ain't happening. We just saw what, they just ripped us off again. And Glasper showed me, you know, redlining is still, they're still doing it again. They're stealing and impoverishing people's, pardon?
No, I said everything just looks beautiful now. They just throw a couple of faces that are marginalized on a flyer and say, look, we believe in equity, and that's what it is.
Yeah.
Because as long as I can get elite status quo people into this position, then everybody else just needs to pull themselves up. But the system, again, those barriers do not allow you to. If you are on the table, you have to stay on the table to maintain the funding for some of these prosperous opportunities through community engagement. That's the problem. It's like, wow, when did that become a good job? I remember I did taxes in Texas, and people that I knew that did community outreach weren't riding around in BMWs and living in condos. That was like an additional work based on like my regular job, and then I volunteered to help my community. That wasn't a job.
This has been going
That's
on.
That's a job. That's a hustle.
This has been going on for a long time. There's books from the 70s called Poverty Pimps.
Yep.
Okay, so it has been going on for a long time. But for me, you know, the disillusionment with, and that's the dilemma of community development, is that poor communities need development. They need jobs. They need solutions, right? Housing, whatever, safety. So you have to do that work. That has to be done. But at the same time, as the overall system is just, the monster is just growing bigger and bigger. The capitalist monster is storming the land, impoverishing and indebting and killing all of us, really. And so I'm disillusioned with these little technocratic solutions. That's not what I'm about. But when I hear you come and talk about these issues of public safety, which have, you know, affected my life, and, you know, but that others are not necessarily, like, I'll tell you one thing that gets me ticked off working here. My dean wants to start a program, and I haven't spoken out about it. See, I've kept it to myself. But my dean, except for a few confidants that I might tell something to, what does he want to do? He wants to start a new master's program in emergency management. Okay, so to worry about, you know, and it's, and you know, not that it isn't a valid thing, you know, like worry about the tsunami, you know, worry about climate change. I'm thinking there's a tsunami in my community right now. And so it offends me, but I haven't spoken out about it yet. You know, I haven't said to them, you need to do X, Y, Z because there's an emergency. But do you see my point? From my point of view, there's an emergency going on. Whether it's poor, homeless, safety, you know, all the things that are going on in Portland that are crisis issues. But, you know, you have to have the courage to speak up about it and
we
to get these institutions to recognize these issues.
They do recognize it. I don't know if you saw the article about Portland State University using FERPA information, you know, Federal Education Rights to Privacy Act, children that are in the communities that I'm speaking about. One of the things that I had done in the early days of advocating was I was trying to like build the gap for the school to prison pipeline. And in doing that, what I realized is, let's say Sun Schools. How many people have heard of Sun Schools?
Okay, so some school programming is like an after-school programming that's set up in some of the communities that are very marginalized. And what I realized is that a lot of those same communities, in respect to the MacArthur Red Foundation report, which is an audit that shows overrepresentation of people of color in our Portland and Multnomah County's jail system, right? Not only the jail system, but even foster care, all those systems are like overrepresented with people of color. So I'm looking at this data, but before I was looking at this data, I was trying to figure out what connections were happening in our community where people were being over-criminalized or just being criminalized based on basic behavioral things. And it came from FERPA. It came from the fact that children that were going into these sub school programs and maybe signing up for a field trip, and signing up for the field trip, they are waiving their federal education rights to privacy up until the age of 25 years old. Now, the fact that from the time that you're in early childhood education, and let's say the same people that started the early childhood education also started the GAIN Task Force. That's a partnership, right? And we're talking about school-to-prison pipeline. Mm-hmm. So let's say in early childhood education, children that are marginalized that might need extra food access or a scholarship to be in that program or going on a field trip or any type of thing where there is a permission are waiving their FERPA rights up until the age of 25. That is giving all of those community policing partners and community bureaus and partners access to the family's record because they waived their rights to privacy. Nobody does that. Nobody does that. But people were made to sign the application. And when we talk about ignorance, well, not knowing that you shouldn't waive them, that's ignorant. And no one's telling me that maybe we're using this data because we're going to be working with Portland State University and we're going to do research and y'all figure out why y'all poor, hungry, dead, dying.
So you're saying somewhere on campus they're using this data?
It's on the news. It's everywhere.
Yeah.
But they've been doing it for a long time, and the fact that they're doing that and the priority of applications that are being submitted are from those very marginalized communications, that shows that there was a maliciousness to that in my mind, because I'm thinking, why would I ask you to waive your FERPA rights so that I don't violate them, right, when I research you? Went to all the schools 2 years ago, got the applications from each desk. I could tell you which schools had them and which applications didn't even have the information on there. And it's just like black and white. Which schools have kids that are children of color? These ones. They all have the FERPA waiver. Which ones don't have children of color? These ones. That FERPA waiver doesn't even exist. And it doesn't say on those applications that if you don't waive your FERPA rights, that you will not be able to get these services. But on these ones, it actually says that too. That you will not be eligible to receive these services that are already paid for, that you're supposed to already get because you're marginalized, unless you waive those rights. People don't see the fine print. If I didn't work for a CPA for 15 years, I probably wouldn't have seen it. And the fact that my nephew had to die for me to look for it is what I'm telling you is a problem and why we're sitting back here having these conversations, because we're not all informed. And if we are more informed than others because we don't communicate with each other, we don't know that it's hurting my neighbor to be in that situation. I don't have somebody take the application to and say, why are they asking me this? That's how I found out. People said, Tressa, what does this mean? Why are they asking me this? I said, I don't know. Let's go to Multnomah County and talk to the auditor, ask them why. Let's tell them they have to take it off. Now let's get lawyers to help them take it off. And guess what? They still didn't. I still got the emails, all 300, 3 million. I keep them. I can't help it. I want my evidence on the record. That's why we testify. That's why we go to city halls and state capitals. It's not to just stop the system, is to stop it, get on the record, and then leave so that they have to do the appropriate response. So that if the media caught it, people will be able to hear it and say, oh, somebody's fighting about that? Let me get involved so I can fight too. Or that happened to my neighbor, let me tell my neighbor that that's happening. To share information, not to stop the world from moving, but to build with the world. Today is International Women's Day, and there's a women's strike that's been happening across the world for decades, and we're going to be hosting that today in solidarity. And what we're doing is we're just basically saying that we know that when the Women's March happened and 70,000 plus women and men and community came together, we know that they came together because they believe in solidarity, they believe in unity,
But I don't believe that that message was inclusive of all of us. I don't think that that message that happened that day included all of us intentionally. I think that we need to become intentional on our inclusion. We have to be intentional on what we see as equity. We have to be intentional on equality. If you go to a space where don't nobody look like me or any people of color, get out of that space and send a message to the promoter or the person that put it together and say, hey man, you can do better. Hey lady, you can do better. Hey, you can do better. But stop making those spaces cool, because it's not okay. We have to be very seriously motivated to be instinctively inclusive, period. Like, it's just the norm. The next generation does not deserve to inherit what mess we have right in this country. And we know our forefathers were wrong. They were racist. They were owners of slaves. They were misogynists of women. So we know it's all bad. We're hearing about it every day. So if we already know what happened and what's been happening, let's start changing the dynamics of what could happen.
So we, and everybody's doing these action plans, and you guys can pull together if you want to do joint action plans. It's okay with me. And you know, so they have to choose an issue, right? And then I gave them some background reading. I hope everybody looked at that BOGO chapter about the difference between a problem and an issue. And so an issue is taking something that may be a problem and talking about a solution for it. Okay? So what kind of issues do you see? It sounds like you're working on several issues.
Public safety is all of those issues. If we are not, if we're hungry, if we're houseless, if we're still dealing with domestic violence, sexual violence, hate crimes, that means our safety is a matter at hand. And so most of the things that I fight for are safety related. Even when I'm in the education system, it's safety focused. So you have to fight for that. And I think that the biggest value in trying to get access to safety is inclusion. So you have to fight a human rights fight for inclusion and equity and equality. And hopefully in that order, make it to where that equity is an equalizer for the people that are supposed to be marginalized that need it. Hold a demand, I mean, you know. Demand an audit, I've done that several times. Those audits are still coming out. That's a very powerful ask when you're putting together a campaign for a community action plan. When you want to know what's happening and you don't want to just point the finger and say this is the problem, you have to build the language to propose an audit. And I think that that's a very, very powerful political tool for activism, because all you're demanding is accountability on the record. And people, when they act like that's a problem, that's when you know there's an issue. Get away with it.
So how about your work? Can you talk about your work with the you know, with the
Youth in McLaren?
Well, you can talk about that, but also the one I saw, the listserv with what's her name on the Emmanuel Displaced, the new Emmanuel Displaced Persons Association, with the money that, when I think of audit, I think of all the money that the city's been spending through the Portland Development Commission and the Bureau of Housing. And
yes.
You know, how much money they spent to gentrify the Albina District, and now they're offering this belated set of crumbs, as far as I'm concerned. But there's been a focus on the site of the Emmanuel Hospital, right?
Yeah.
Russell and Williams. Are you involved in that?
Right. Well, a couple of years ago, I think, what was it, 2012, I did an Albina storytelling project with my friend Chris. He's a broadcaster at Portland Community Media, or Open Signal. And we basically partnered up with Jenna Woolley and some of the people from 1970 that were a part of the original Albina neighborhood, Emmanuel Hospital, like, gentrification. Let's call it what it is. It was gentrification. But they called it the Portland Plan, and there were all these community leaders that were a part of those meetings. But there were also a bunch of community leaders that were looking at everything that was happening, like how the city of Portland brought in a leader for the NAACP or the Urban League that basically said, yeah, we want to work with the PDC, and how the PDC partners were all people that were motivated to build their own self-worth or wealth or whatever you want to call it. But basically, the opportunists helped sell out the community, and some of the community leaders like Ms. Warren and some other people, Harvey Rice's mom. I interviewed all these people that were in their 80s and 90s, and they talked about it. They were like, yeah, we got bamboozled. We were having meetings. We were organizing in our churches. We were organizing everywhere. We knew this was a hustle. They told us that, you know, they were going to do community development. in the area around around Emanuel Hospital, and that by giving up our houses to the eminent domain process, that we would be able to be first on the list to come back and have access to housing. Well, if you go in that area right now, like, they're just now starting to build stuff, and this is like 1970, which would be almost 50 years ago. And so it's like, wait a minute, so you had all these people move out of the neighborhood for 10, 20, 30 years. Then as gentrification happens, you start redeveloping that neighborhood with the same focus in mind that, look, we're making affordable housing for these people that we forced out 30 years ago, 40 years ago. And the affordable housing now, they could be included if they sign up for this other little hustle that we got. Like, there's so many hustles entangled together that really, to me, it's still a form of collecting data, like, who used to live here that's still in Portland? Get them to sign up for this housing over here, and they're gonna be on the first come, first serve list. Who else used to, you know, like, everything's about collecting our information. Nothing is about a return on investment. So when they keep saying equity, and they got it around people of color and marginalized communities, you better check that hustle, because that's exactly what it is, period.
How would you see more justice coming out of that whole thing?
I think that we need to hold on to it. I've been talking to some people over at Multnomah County, and we kind of got the PDC to hold off. We told them that we had a steering committee of community members that used to live there, and that we wanted to distribute the information about the opportunities to all of those members so that they could have a voice in the matter. And we asked for like 18 months. We were like, yeah, give us like 18 months to like have these conversations. And they were like, okay. And so the people that I charged to do that, my friend Rashad and those guys, they was like, whoa, that stuff happened. They like gave us time off. What do we do now? And I'm like, well, they know that everything's built up against us. They have the gatekeepers at the table that have access to all the resources at the PDC at a drop of a dime. They can send out marketing materials, information, and all this other stuff, but they're not. They're gonna leave it on us with no resources, no access to all of these addresses, people, or anything to try to figure it out. And I'm gonna tell you, in the next 18 months, we're not all gonna be sitting at the table. Some of us might be dead. Some of us gonna be talking about the group ain't doing shit. We're not gonna get anywhere because we don't have the resources to do it.
Yeah,
but we gotta try, and so.
Well, you know what? I've written about this project, okay, when it first started.
I've seen it, and I've read it.
And one of the things that you can do is ask them to extend the Urban Renewal District another 10 years and get more money from them, because this really is a hook, I think, that you could try to get a real redistributive.
Well, this is the thing where we talk about who has access to privilege and resources and who don't. Right? Some of us go to those meetings and then they change the agenda item to the next meeting or the next meeting so that they can avoid it. Mm-hmm. And they use that time to kind of power up the gatekeepers, the people that have to maintain the credibility of the patriarchy against what you're saying should be fair. And so this is the thing that academia could do. Like, how you've written on it, you can write on it again. Your class could be instructed to use it as a power tool, and you can go in there and you can activate in support of those people there. Just going on the record at the PDC during this time and speaking to the atrocity of what they have in our history and how they accumulated and acquired all of that property, that's enough right there to stop them. It's enough right there to get the funding. It's enough right there to build community engagement to go ahead and really develop that area so that it doesn't continue to be a gentrification asset, you know? It could actually turn it around. Like, that much power is in this room. But unless you have people that have that access to that power, using it to influence you to wield that power, you'll never know what it looks like. I've seen the power from this campus. I've seen it over and over again, and I know that the motivation can be there if it's inspired and encouraged. So I hope that's what she's doing, because she knows way more about it than I do.
Yeah, we have teaching a class next term. If anybody wants to jump in and do that project, we could do that. I'm teaching a community economic development class. And in the past, I did a project on interstate, and that was like 2011. And we got a lot of community feedback. We held community meetings. There's still so much hurt behind you know, for blacks and whites who lived there, mm-hmm. about that Russell and Williams, the destruction of that site, you know, and
they lived in that neighborhood together, and people keep saying the black community and this community, that was a very multicultural community. Yeah. Like, my family, my great grandmother is from McMinnville, and she is Irish.
you know what I'm saying, literally McMurphy, Murphy. But I'm just saying, like, our community, it wasn't, when I came back home after living in Texas and it was segregated, that tripped me out, because all my friends, Hun Nguyen, Janae, you know, all these different people were from different parts of the world, and we all lived in Portland, and we all grew up together, and we were not segregated as children going to King's School and Harriet Tubman and all that stuff. So I don't know where it became a hustle, pretty much. Like, on the record, that's what it became. It became legitimized through legislation and segregation. And we have made it appropriate because guess what? We love equity and we want to be the saviors, and I want to help the blacks and I want to help the Asians and I want to help the disabled and I want to help the LGBT. And the only way I can help them is by breaking them apart and putting them in different segments so that I can have access to seeing what they're doing and where I can be helpful. They're humans. We need helpful by promoting public safety and communication and information to communities so that they can build together. Because when you start building your community together, when your kids is being raised together and they work together and they go to school together, you're used to living together. That's like normal, unless somebody goes in there with their immoral ideas for money and they segregate it. And they say, you're valuable over here and you guys are valuable over here, and Black History Month, y'all are the most valuable people, and Mardi Gras coming up and y'all more, you know, like, really? I came back and that's what we have in Portland. Like, it's cool to be segregated. That's weird. And I think it's, I guess y'all think it's cool to be weird too.
So to you, it's more to segregated me, than it
it's
was
very
before.
Segregated. I was never, we didn't even, like, everybody's family is mixed. So how do you segregate your community that's right there with you? I came back to that. Like, community members is on different sides of the stages because of the different opportunity to economics. Like, shoot, me being bright skinned, I can go over here and get more money unless I hang out with my brother Mondo, and then if people see me together with him, then it's gonna be a problem. Like, that became the problem. Like, we segregated people based on how they looked and how they were approved by society and how people socialize who they are and what they're doing with who you are. So now I don't wanna hang out with my friends because they look bad. Or they used to be bad, or something. I just gotta get away from bad so I can look good. Really? It really don't matter. We live in a shithole country. You know what I'm saying? So you can't really get the shit off of you unless you start doing some shit that matters. Period.
Any questions?
What's the name of the group for the project that they're doing in
The Albino Storytellers?
Well, not the storytellers so much, but like the 18 months you guys had to.
It's the PDC, and we don't have a name for the group. It was really one of my friends. She probably won't want me to name her. She's always like, I'm anonymous. Don't be putting my name out there. But she's a very intellectual librarian that's really into archivism. And so her work in anthropology and archives gave us all of these documents that showed, like, all these improprietary uses of, like, these political ties. It's like, oh, you just threw away a whole community so that you could prioritize your values and monetary values. And Kara's done the research. I read her research. I'm like, whoa, it's in writing and they're still doing it. And people still, just like I know, he's dead and people still don't know he got killed by white supremacists. And he's a kid and they are killing kids. They're chasing parents. I had a friend, CJ, who's a videographer, and he's like, yeah, I got chased with my backpack and I'm a grown man from Oklahoma, but I know when I see the truck and I see him chasing me, I know I gotta go, because I'm from down there. Out here, people are standing up to him and getting ran over, fighting them and getting killed. And they know they're gonna get away with it, because guess what, I'm scared of him. And guess what, the people that's in front of you, that you telling you scared of that black person, guess what, they scared of black people too. They've been socialized to think that we're crazy, we're strong, we're powerful, we're monsters. And I know it for a fact, because if I'm walking down the street and there's a white lady with her kids, and I'll be telling people all the time, they pull their kids away like as if it could be a wide sidewalk, and they're not pulling them because they think that, you know, the kid's gonna be in my way. They scared that I might get next to their child, that their kid might look at me, say hi. I see that, I'm a parent. I've never done that to my kids. Unless it's somebody that's scary that I think might be really a dangerous person, but not just a random woman walking down the street, you know, because they're, you know, a different color than me. I would never let my kids think that that's okay. You know? But we're not in that world yet. We've adapted to being cool and clean and neat and fresh in our shithole country. We so cool. Any more questions?
Do you work with high school kids at all? You don't?
Yeah. Yes, all the time. Hopefully I'll be doing some protesting with them. I'm gonna be at the Buckman Art Show on Saturday doing a big giant community art project so that the kids can have additional banners and signs for the 24th and also for the assassination anniversary of Martin Luther King on April 4th. So if you guys know about Buckman, it's their 29th annual art event, but I've been doing more and more with the kids because I'm right now in the middle of like a lawsuit against the city for illegally arresting me, and I think it's safer for me to kind of show and share the knowledge for organizing reasons than to kind of like, you know, get attacked and hurt. I think like the races are more mad about me suing the city than the actual police or the mayor or anybody like that, because how dare you, you know, if you're considered a criminal or a terrorist, how dare you stand up for your rights or demand to be heard in court?
Yeah, you're being discredited.
Yeah, they want me to get killed.
We talk about how they discredit leaders.
I discredited them in the courtroom, now they gotta pay me, so now they wanna kill me. Go figure. I'm gonna put my money back in the community.
So can you talk about organizing? What do you like about it? How do you define it?
How does it satisfy?
To me, nonviolent direct action. I think when I organize about nonviolent direct actions, I think about building a campaign, a messaging campaign to basically promote an issue that is very necessary to be promoted in a very nonviolent way that directly influences someone to respond. So let's say that, like for instance, I was trying to get people to realize this police contract had came up for October of 2016. There was a police contract for their collective bargaining. And for years, I had taken activists and people that would listen to me and show up at our events to these meetings with the CRC and all these different government entities where you could speak against police. You know, you could say, this is what happened to me and this is what needs to happen. And these people are the deciders of dealing with policy, of building new policy. So if you're speaking to them about the issues that are happening, they're the people with the power to kind of create and establish new protocols. But with the collective bargaining agreement, like all of those years of speaking out and making these complaints and filing accommodations and, you know, just different types of things, now we can work with the Civil Rights Department, the auditor, and we can help bring community voices in to this process so that they can include what we felt about the recommendations in the collective bargaining agreement. Because guess what? That's the agreement between the city and the union to make sure that public safety for all of us is a part of what they're going to be doing in their directives as employees of the police bureau. And that's where everybody, including the union president, told me that I needed to go if we wanted to make a change. He told me, Gerald Turner said, if you really want to make change, the protest is not going to help you. What you have to do is you have to be at the table during the collective bargaining agreement so that you can have your voice heard, and then we can deal with those recommendations. And this is how it works. Your mayor, the commissioners, the auditor, and my signature mandate what's going to happen. So if they're wearing body cams, if there's a 48-hour rule, if they can choke you and kill you, if they can beat you 12 times before it's considered deadly force or excessive force, all those different things, if they shoot you while your hands up, or if they're, you know, any of those things, the time to talk about it is at the table during the collective bargaining agreement. So I'm like, okay, cool. So from the time he told me that, I started building all these community outreach programs where the dialogue was about the collective bargaining, what we needed to know, how we needed to know it, who we needed to speak to in our communities, how we could share information, so that we could be ready. Next thing you know, I'm thinking, okay, collective bargaining is June 2017, but it's September 23rd, 2016, and we're protesting. We get downtown, and I'm getting attacked by the police, so I take the protest into City Hall. I demand to see the mayor, and they're like, he's in a meeting. Where is he in a meeting with? The commissioners, the union boss, and they have a draft for a collective bargaining agreement. The collective bargaining agreement is not supposed to be due for a draft until June of 2017. This is October 2016. So what did I do? I didn't have any power to stop them from doing this draft. It was a legal meeting that they had without the community. They didn't have to keep us because it's concerning their will on our engagement. So I started a protest. People said, what are you going to do? I said, well, everybody show up with tents and sleep.
and we're gonna go in there and we're gonna testify. And so I staged this big old giant art exhibit. I threw a 60-foot long orange banner, Black Lives Matter, on City Hall, along with Don't Shoot, some, you know, voters posters that said, you know, vote on September 27th or register to vote on September, just all this different propaganda to get people involved so that they could understand what was going on. Then I went to the Independent Police Review and grabbed a stack of the drafts of the collective bargaining agreement, passed them out to everybody that showed up, put up a projector, showed 13th Amendment by Ava right there in front of City Hall with the PA system so people in the Justice Center could hear it. Did this for about 3 days till we could get on the agenda to go in there and make our voices heard. They shut it off. They shut us down. They took it off the agenda, and so we had to wait till the next week. The thing is, every Wednesday, we kept going back so that we could just clearly say, hey, whatever reason you're fast-tracking this collective bargaining agreement makes no sense. You have people protesting in the streets for the last 5 years from Occupy to Black Lives Matter, and right now, if we don't get a voice on the collective bargaining agreement for 2017, then we're not going to have an opportunity again until 2020, 2022. And so right now it's very detrimental because, first of all, we're tired of protesting. How much elevation of messaging can you do so that people know that they need to be engaged? And at this point of very serious, necessary engagement, you told us that we were going to do this together to stop it. But right now you're kind of deflecting from us and you're fast-tracking it. Why? You got to ask, why would you sign something that doesn't need to be signed in October when it needs to, it doesn't need to be signed until the next year in June? Why would you fast-track it? And so we started the protest so that we could push that messaging out, and that's what we did. And we got beat up. They assaulted us by October 13th after weeks of getting different organizations like the Sierra Club and the ACLU and, you know, all these basic rights org and all these people to start coming out and speaking, and even the auditor saying, we're thankful that they stopped the draft because this is what needs to be included. Everybody got a chance, weeks worth a chance to add their voices to the reason that this shouldn't be fast-tracked. After they beat us up and humiliated us, nothing happened. It got signed that same day. They threw us out of City Hall while they gave us tickets and signed us up to speak on the record. But it was a very serious public humiliation, and all the news said a violent protest happened at City Hall during a collective bargaining agreement. Protesters stormed City Hall and da-da-da. We were invited in, we were given papers, we were given tickets, we were sat down. We walked out of the chambers because the commissioners walked out, went upstairs. We sat outside. There was a big loudmouth kid running around with a bullhorn, but nobody really cared too much about what was happening with that. We were still humiliated. They signed a collective bargaining agreement. Nobody got to speak on the record at all, and we're still here. And we still got kids. Like, after that, 7 more people got killed by the Portland police in 1 year. Right after that. And even the priority of them being able to shoot like Qantas Hayes with no body cams on after we went to the state legislature and fought two or four or against them, but bringing that subject to the people, saying, hey, we should have a look at body cams. They might not always work for us, but they got to have them. They have them. They didn't use them. When they arrested me, they turned them off. But these are the things that we're protesting against. These are the things that are in the collective bargaining agreements. These are the reasons that we occupy spaces and elevate our voices. These are the reasons you got to look past the comments and the articles, and you have to connect with the activists and ask them, what can you do to help? Because really just elevating the messaging is the most important thing.
Do you find it effective to call out specific members of either city government or state government in exposing any legislation that they passed or action that they've taken against people that are marginalized, like specific political candidates?
I think austerity matters, and I'm always telling Nick Fish that, like, whoa, it's funny that you're trying to treat me like a second-class citizen, because in a couple of years it's going to look bad that you did that. You know what I'm saying? So it's always good because you get to remind them that everything they do is on the record. It's on the physical government record. In Washington State, I think last week, they just passed some bill that cleared like all of their old obligations. My friend just sent it to me last night. I'll send it to your teacher, but it's ridiculous because it basically takes away their accountability to the past. It says, well, whatever you did back in the day, it won't be exposed, and we'll just make sure that the legislator understands that. And it wasn't, you know, like all of the politicians said, hell yeah, I'm passing that, because guess what? They probably did improprietary stuff or said things in email or electronic transmission that they don't want the general public to know about. But I think in our country, We should never even allow language like that to be written in any type of bill, because the only power that we have is actual knowledge of what's on the record. Like, archives matter, you know? So yes, I think it is to be exposed, and I think for the fundamental reason that we're talking about today, so that knowledge can help you dismantle or disseminate or change or make something happen or develop your ideas or program differently. But if you don't have the knowledge for the basis to build from and it's not connected to you directly, you're not gonna care. But if you find out, show me now, please, because they don't need to be in business of community service. That's what they are.
This is a little probably simpler. Do you have any activists that inspired you when you were growing up?
Oh God, when I was growing up, I thought Michael Jackson was an activist. I'm serious. I thought Stevie Wonder, like all of those people to me were activists. Dr. King, because I went to King School. Harriet Tubman, you know, like everybody. I went to Tubman, so I mean, come on. My family is from Natchez, Mississippi, and just recently I learned about our history, and I learned that our family owned the NAACP office where Medgar Evers and his wife worked when he was murdered, and that our auntie, my great auntie Hattie Mae, is actually one of the people. She was the treasurer, and she started the Medgar Evers Foundation. So just people around me, everybody that was around me, my grandma, she was an activist. She had like a third grade education and 10 kids, and she was still able to raise me. And you know, she was a voter. She used to have the voters pamphlet. She's the one that taught me about politics. And I'm like, you didn't even know how to read. She said, my kids taught me how to read. They'd come home with their books and they'd be reading, and they thought she knew, you know, she's helping them with their homework, but they taught her how to read. And she was a janitor her whole life, my whole life. I remember Coach Janitorial. She worked at the federal building, cleaning the floors, the toilets, all that. You know, and she was humble. She'd come home and take care of us. Like, after her 10 kids, then she had, like, all these grandkids that their parents were on crack and heroin and everything else, and she still had the capacity to care about us, to show up at school, to speak out, to elect people, to encourage us to volunteer in our communities. Like, those, everybody around me was a hero to me, my friends, parents, everybody, my teachers, Myrna, everybody. The people in, I mean, I did safety patrol. I thought the people that taught us safety patrol were like superheroes. Y'all know how to make the car stop? Now I know how to make the car stop, but. Any other questions?
Any other questions? Go on.
You kind of talked about it earlier, how a lot of these institutions are disenfranchising, you know, a lot of the groups, and how businesses and things like that should be really funneling in resources into them, because that's like a better way to uplift. Do you think, like, the Justice Department, the Police Department, and all those things, do you think there's an avenue for them to change?
Well, if they stop doing community policing, like, take them out of the business of community policing, having a priority that a state policing agent has to be involved in education, health, jobs, all of those things, like, it's too much. Even the kids that are out there in Parkland, they're talking about, we don't want more SROs, we don't want our teachers with guns. Like, who wants that in their world? You know, who wants to go to school with the knowledge that if I'm hungry that day, instead of you wondering if my mom is okay, you're trying to figure out how to take me away from her. You know, like my mom was going through domestic violence when they put us in foster care. And they didn't think, like, maybe we should help the family, maybe we should save the mom. They took the kids and put us in danger because nobody had a priority to protect children that were wards of the state, because guess what? The state is the ward. There's no safety in that. Only violence. When those kids speak out against abuse, molestation, just all the humiliating things that happen to you when you're taken away from your family and it's a risk of harm to let you have contact with them, that's a policing state. That's a state of policing. We should not have any of that in regards to our families and our communities. That's why I'm always pushing on build community, because what if your neighbors cared about what was happening? What if you knew they cared and you could go to them for help? What if you could talk to your family about things that hurt and your family knew people that cared and they could connect you with those things? That's how America used to be. When I talked to my mom and my grandma and all those guys, when they used to talk to us, they say, in our neighborhood, we could walk down the street, get in trouble, and get whooped three times before we got home.
like everybody knew each other, and that world doesn't exist. You know, we need to bring something back that looks like a human gesture of caring, like, you know, regular consideration and respect. I don't know how to get it back when everything is so important in my tech device, you know, but we have to figure it out and we have to fight for it because our children are inheriting what we have now, and there's no way to build community when your community is closed in on a social network. Like, I think the biggest part of building, when they were talking about ending net neutrality and everybody was worried, like, oh, shoot, we're going to lose the internet. I was like, damn, people are going to start talking again. We're going to be back outside. We're going to be going places. People are going to have dinner with their children, and they're not going to have a technology device at the table anymore. Like, we're going to actually start going places together and caring about it, not having to be seen there, but spending the time building a memory in the space where we're together. Like, those things I remember. I bet you there's a generation that don't even know what I'm talking about. And that's scary.
So did you say they should not do community policing?
There should not be any community policing. Not by the state, not by the police. They shouldn't be in every spectrum. They're not in certain communities. They're just in communities where brown people are. Mm-hmm. And the words that are attached to us are at risk, marginalized, you know what I'm saying? And I'm like, why aren't racists at risk or marginalized? Why don't we marginalize bad things in our community rather than people? You know, we don't make those people at risk. We make them comfortable, and we say that I'm at risk because if I make them uncomfortable, they could kill me. Or if I make somebody uncomfortable, like, everybody's gonna be happy that I'm removed from that situation. But those people that hate and promote that they do hate, nobody's trying to make them uncomfortable. We don't even call them gangs, or thugs, or extremists, or terrorists. I don't call any of those things, but I've been called those things.
What do you think about the police?
I think she's a police officer. I think that she was in Oakland.
What was the question?
I think Oakland outlaw.
I was asking her what she thought about the new police.
The new? I think it's timely that she was, like, I was actually talking to a police officer on the phone because they needed some connection with our organization. And they didn't know that there was a new police chief. And this was August 9th on the anniversary of Mike Brown's murder, which was also the day that I got arrested, which is weird that that's the same day that we got the announcement that we had a new black woman chief of police while you're erasing another black woman that's from this community who, like, could probably connect really good with the city as the mayor and the next police commissioner. Like,
I'm
about to be the mayor. 2020, baby, let's go. Get my energy up.